This is an Astor PN-C24J car radio, an Australian car radio that was made around 1968. They're also known as air chiefs. There was another version out called the MN-C24J, and that didn't have any push buttons. The owner of the radio still has the front panel and the knobs, so that's why I haven't included them in this video. I'm going to cover the repair of the radio in highlights because the whole thing took quite some time and it would have made a long and boring video if I was to show everything that needed to be done to it. So I'll give you the highlights of that. I'll let you have a listen to it before that. And at the end, there's an anomaly I came up with some capacitors on it that I can't quite explain. So if any of the viewers to this video have got an idea what's happening there, I'd be very interested in what the solution is. Anyway, there's going to be a number of 5, 10 and 50 kilowatt stations that you'll hear that are 100 to 200 kilometres away from here. There are no local AM stations. I'm in a country area. I'm running it off a DC supply and I'm using an external long wire aerial, which is cheating a bit, but I'm in a shielded building, so I can't just put up a bit of wire inside and see how it goes, because you won't pick up anything much at all. But with the external wire, it works very well, as you're just about to hear. So I'll start with a 50 kilowatt station that's 200 kilometers away.
Actually, it's much more about really nailing it technically and being part of the instrumentation, because everybody is saying something to everybody else in there, and the success of his music is that that will work together.
The power amplifier is meant to be capable of 8 watts, and there's lots of distortion free audio, so I'll turn it up and let you hear what it's capable of, albeit hopefully that it doesn't distort in the camera, but it sounds quite clear here.
Whether it's just natural, I suspect the second, we will never know.
He was writing so fast, especially these cantatas.
Every week.
You can't really imagine him kind of working on charts and so on. No,
that's about 2 or 3 watts. I'll let you hear a bit more on that on music shortly. I've got a tune with a screwdriver blade here without the knobs.
Cantatas sing a lot of Handel, but they're not cantata rolls, are they?
Depends.
There we go. A bit more volume.
Some of his oratorios at the end of it. Some of his oratorios.
Bedford's already mentioned one,
and I watched like
that's
the,
a 10 kilowatt station 100 kilometers away.
Him and what you know, him and
throttle, a mezzo, a bass, sometimes depending on who was ill, and there was a counter.
That's similar, 10 kilowatts,
so
100
even,
kilometers.
It would even drop an octave to be
clear. And now we've got a music station that's 200 kilometers away that's 5 kilowatts. Watch the copyright. I'll give you an example of the audio again on that.
What's wrong with that? I like to know. Cause here I go.
Okay. This copyright thing keeps you rushing around. And there we go, another 5 kilowatt music station, but this one's 100 kilometers away. Turn it up. Right, now we'll go through some of the parts I replaced and what I found. Firstly, those output transistors, they are currently AD149s, but they started off as AT Alpha Tango 1138s. This radio is full of Australian transistors from the late 1960s. And they're all silicon transistors, except the output stage there, which is germanium. They didn't have their act together making high power silicon output transistors in the late 1960s. So they were still using germanium. They're both PNPs. And they were curious to diagnose as being faulty. just hang on a second there and I'll show you the original ones. So these are the original transistors. And as you can see, they're quite corroded. But it's difficult to diagnose faulty germanium transistors with a multimeter because even though you're told, you know, a silicon transistor gives you a 0.6 to 0.7 of a volt drop from the base to the emitter junction and base to collector junction, and germanium should be about 0.2 or 0.3, with these, I found that even though the meter said they're all right, they weren't all right at all. And I had to use my transistor curve tracer, my homebrew transistor curve tracer, to show that they were faulty. And anyway, what I'll do is I'll show you on the meter the type of readings you get. And then I'll compare that with a good transistor. I did get a third spare transistor. And I'll show you that as a comparison with that one. And then I'll show you on the curve tracer what it really looks like and what they're really performing like. Something I can do just before that is show you the output stage in question here. So that's it there with these two transistors being faulty, and all the DC voltages around them were quite wrong. And when I got this radio, there wasn't a peep coming out of it. So the first thing to do was have a look at the output stage. All right, now I just set up for the test on the transistor. Okay, these are testing the transistors I was talking about. This being PNP, the negative goes on the base. So we get 0.15 there, base to collector, and 0.153 there, base to emitter. So we reverse them, base to collector nothing, base to emitter nothing, and also collector to emitter should be nothing in both directions, except when I got my finger across it. Well, there's another interesting anomaly. We're getting 0.95 with the positive on the emitter and the negative on the collector. Such are the vagaries of trying to measure germanium transistors on a meter. Anyway, these are the faulty ones. So the first one tells us we shouldn't get anything there and we shouldn't get anything there. As you can see, we don't. So it looks all right. Reverse bias, nothing happens. Forward bias, 0.14, 0.143. Now that shows us that there's something not very good going on between the collector and the emitter. And indeed that does too. So that's a hint that there's something not very happy with these transistors, but they pass the two diode test. Right, now 0.138, 0.141, nothing, collector emitter. Oh, here we go, this is a good one. Collector emitter here and collector emitter here. Oh, we got 0.1 that direction and we got nothing in that direction. So both transistors, both of these faulty old transistors, are testing okay forward bias from base to collector and base to emitter, and yet they're different, collector to emitter, and different again from the transistor that's okay. So I thought this is all a bit hard to understand. I better put them on my curve tracer. So I'll set up the curve tracer for you and let you have a look at what I found. Okay, that's the good transistor. And being a PNP transistor, the display is negative. The curves are negative. And now I'll show you what the faulty transistors look like. Turn the intensity down there. So as you can see, it's gone right off the screen. So bring it back up again. Yeah, there we go. and reduce the, there it is. It's hard to fit the whole thing in. I can magnify it out that a bit. There we go. What a strange looking shape that is. I'll bring it in like that because we're only after relative measurement, not absolute figures. So that's what one of the output transistors look like. And that's certainly not what your transfer curves for a germanium transistor are supposed to be. So that's the first one, and I'll put the second one on. Get it the right way around. Okay, and that's the other one. A 45 degree line is just a resistance, and there's not much in the way of different traces there for the different base currents. So it's almost just like a resistor, according to that. And yet the readings on the meter were very, very different. So what I'm trying to show here is that what the multimeter tells you of a germanium transistor and what in reality is happening with the transfer curves can be quite different, and that's why I ended up finding them to be faulty using this method and not the multimeter. The multimeter is too ambiguous. It's a quick, easy test for a lot of things, but in this case it just isn't good enough. So having found that these output transistors were faulty and then replacing them, the next thing was these two transistors. These were the driver transistors. They're also PNPs, as you can see. And one of them, I don't know how, but there seemed to have been some sort of stress problem with the leads on these, because both of them were broken. The leads were broken where they went off into the case of the transistor. And in the case of one of them, only one of the leads was broken, so I was able to resolder the lead, and that worked okay. But in the other one, when I went to unsolder the transistor, the whole thing just fell apart. The leads fell off it. So that was very strange in itself. So the original transistors here, you might be able to read that okay, an AT436. And, well, they're pretty hard to get these days too. So I ended up putting in a TT649. These are probably transistors that you haven't heard of, but they were, in this case, silicon transistors from the late 1960s, and I happen to have a few of those around. So they were replaced. And of course, it almost goes without saying with this that all the capacitors were replaced, all the electrolytic capacitors were replaced first, and many, many, many resistors were replaced, which a lot of them are 10% resistors, but the weird thing that happened here too was that a lot of them showed more than being 10% out, going high as usual, really high in some cases. But when I desoldered them, their values changed again. And this happened in many, many cases. Their values changed again, and they were still more than 10% out. So they were worth replacing, but it just showed you how unstable they have become. I left some of the original resistors in there, but not many. And it shows too in a radio, in a car environment where it's subjected to high temperatures, low temperatures, and high humidity, just the toll it takes on components compared to a radio which is in a house. It may be in an air-conditioned environment, but it's certainly not as extreme as a car, and how much better the components fare over a period of time, and far, far fewer need replacing. So now we've got all the transistors and the audio amplifier working properly. We've got the resistors and the capacitors working properly, but it's still not working. Why isn't it working now? Or at least it was working with distortion. This choke was the problem. So here's the original choke, and it's just a center tap push-pull winding. Well, one of the sides to the center tap is open circuit. So there's really only a winding between the center tap and one side and not the other. So half of the drive for the audio to the output transistors wasn't there either. So what was I going to do about that? Because you can't go out and buy one of these things easily these days. So what I did, this is the transformer section of the radio. This is the speaker transformer filter choke. And this is the one I replaced this choke that I was just talking about with. This is actually a center tap transformer. So it has a primary winding and a center tap secondary for driving transistors normally. But it's of a similar size, a little bit bigger, but it didn't have any the right sort of mounting brackets on there. And it's very difficult to fit it in the radio so that when this is closed over, it doesn't hit anything underneath. So I made this curious arrangement with two long screws and the piece of fiberglass going across the top there to hold it in there. But I'm only using the secondary. I'm not using the primary winding at all. So I'm just using the secondary as a choke. And that fixed the audio problem up. So now the audio amplifier was working. Well, now that the audio amplifier was going, that was good, but the RF section wasn't going at all. Dead as a doornail. So what was wrong there? Well, there were several things wrong there, but one of the first things that needed to be done was to get the IF amplifier going, because that wasn't even going at all. And the main reason there was that the circuit board in this area was cracked. And I think it had been caused by the top of the radio being closed at some stage and something being in the way, and it's pushed on the circuit board and pushed it down and put a crack in it. So some of the traces there were open circuit completely. Some of them were intermittent, and it required a lot of bridging and a lot of soldering and repairing the circuit board, gluing it back together to making sure that that was stable. So that got the IF amplifier going. I'll swap circuit diagrams here to part A. So now we have this IF amplifier, of which there's two of them, of course, quite common in this sort of radio, going. And we can feed in a signal, 455 kilohertz, and that was amplifying okay. But the radio still wasn't working. Or should I say it wasn't quite working. What I could do was from the mixer here, we've got a separate local oscillator here, so I could feed in an external local oscillator into this line here, and lo and behold, the radio started going. And I thought, ah, the local oscillator is not running. And this is where we start coming to what happens with the capacitors in this radio, which is very strange indeed. And I'll set the ones up that I took out. There are both ceramic and also polystyrene capacitors in this radio, and the polystyrene ones were put in order to promote stability and all the good things that those sort of capacitors, when they were made, would give you. Well, it didn't quite work that way with this radio, as you'll see. I should have mentioned that this trimmer capacitor here, which that is the original one of, that was short circuit as well. So that was something else that was stopping the local oscillator. But the polystyrene capacitors, they're everywhere in the RF section of this radio. Here, 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 here. Up here across the IF transformers. They're everywhere. And they're meant to be really good, but these were really not so good. Well, some of them are not so good, but it's the way you measure them that's causing the interesting anomaly. Hang on. So first we start with a very old way of measuring capacitors, RLC bridge. And I can tell you that these two are faulty and those four aren't. So here's an example of one of the faulty ones. It's meant to be 100 picofarad capacitor. Well, on this meter it says it's 100. And on this meter it also says it's 100, if you can see it dipping there. But, yes, but on this meter it says, well, it's 7.7 or 8 picofarads there, and part of that's me touching it. So why is it that this meter says it's faulty, less than 10 picofarads, whereas the other two meters say it's okay at 100? Very strange. Now, to show you there's nothing funny going on here, This is one of the capacitors out of the radio that's okay, saying it's about 220 picofarads. So this meter's fine with this one. And so is this one. And quickly changing over to my old analog RLC bridge. And I have got another RLC bridge that verifies all this stuff. Here we go. This one should be 220, so going up, and there's the dip there, quite a pronounceable dip. You'll notice that the dip is a lot better on this good capacitor than it was on the faulty. But there is a dip on the faulty one. Now I'll show you the other faulty one. So this one is meant to be 56, and it says it's 63. This is the same capacitor, and it's nulling nicely. Just under 60, so it looks good, but it really isn't any good, because here we are, the same capacitor, meant to be 56, is only 6.2. So why is it that this meter, out of these two, and even others I've got, is the only meter, and I'm not being paid by Peak to say this, really, this LCR45 is the only meter that can read the fault in these capacitors properly. If I didn't have this meter and I was going on the others, I would have thought they were okay. So what's going on there? If any of you viewers, listeners can enlighten me as to why this meter measures differently and gives an accurate result, whereas on any other normal capacitor, on any other occasion, any of the meters will read the same. But there's something strange about the way these capacitors have gone faulty that only that meter can pick up. So I'd be very curious to know if anybody's got any answers. Anyway, that's a very, very quick run over as to what's been going on with this radio. I hope you've enjoyed it. It's been necessarily brief, but it gives you some sort of idea of you might have to go through if you're going to be fixing a car radio that's been many, many decades out in all weather conditions and humidities and temperature changes of the extreme variety. All the best. Bye for now.